Okay, thank you very much. I'm Claus Weiland from the Senckenberg Institute of Brandenburg, a large biodiversity provider, slowly images come out. My talk is about last year's biohacking use case, and I tried to expand a little bit on this. It's about mapping or bridging the gap between biodiversity knowledge graphs and machine learning. So the motivation for this project was the increasing availability of environmental and phenotype and genomics data for wild-type organisms made available by European infrastructure and robot infrastructure projects, some were mentioned already. There is the Elixir, of course, for everything knowledge. There is DISCO, the distributed system of collections for museum objects. And there is EnviFair, which is a large umbrella for environmental environmental projects. And these produce, of course, various types of digital data, like sequences, annotation, occurrences, and traits. And they can be captured, as we heard already today several times, comprehensive knowledge graphs. This is, of course, a simplification because these knowledge graphs involve a complex ecosystem of identifiers, registries, protocols, domain ontologies, or curation ontologies, like the biological collection ontology. These knowledge graphs at the end capture interactions and similarity between taxa, so you can do similarity analysis on different collection objects, for example, and provide us such a use case for machine learning. This is a visualization of what we are planning to do with digital objects in DISCO, the collection project of the EU. There's a digital specimen, and attached to the digital specimen as a digital object, there are several kinds of resources, for example, images like the picture of the animals, the West African Plants database created by Senckenberg, or some are probably familiar with this, occurrence data and the taxonomic level. This is geographical visualization from GBIF. Likewise, all of you are familiar with that, of course, fast file from GBank or a trait database, in this case, our own database, the Flowpool KNB, with some traits extracted from flora's referring to a particular object like fleshy fluid, spiky interference, and so on. Considering these knowledge graphs and considering the machine learning of them, there appears a gap of these knowledge graphs and the machine learning algorithms. This is probably obviously for everyone. For me, it's still a phenomenon. I mean, these knowledge graphs, of course, they rest on symbolic representations. I mean, they're particularly expressed in ontologies. We already heard of the ENVO, of course, by environmental features, gene ontology, everybody's familiar with that, for function of genes and so on, and domain ontologies or phenotypes, or our own flow. And these are highly symbolic representations of entities. For example, this is part of produces global with an entity quality matching. There is mentioned plant ontology, just the old term for food and term for Pedro, and we mix these two together and describe the phenotypes using old syntax, and the outcome of this is shown below, and around the structure of something which has complex logical representations and relations and so on. Compared to the machine learning, it's based on sub-symbolic feature vectors. So there is no logic there, it's more derived historically from statistical learning patterns. You can do the world like my mother, but the first thing you have to do is convert that thing into a numerical vector, kind of representation. This is probably one of the simplest ones called one-mod encoding, where I have a length, a vector in the length of the corpus this term is taken from. And I just encode the presence of that thing with a number, and then a binary representation feeds that in a here very simple to lay network called word web, probably some of you are familiar with that, and map this vector to an output function, which just computes the probability that the given input word is semantically related to the output process. So the output is the length of the whole corpus. You have all the words which are presented in that corpus and widespread probability place, but there are, of course, many more, like other plant types which are referred to. And you just can look at that frequently correlated to phylogeographic, and that's probably the case. What makes a difference here, I mean, to stress the point, is that all this logic is going to the right extent. So it's going to be just something like something in a vector, which we can again convert or compute from that probability distribution. But we use, of course, a lot of this really structure, this approach, of course, was from reason and this process. So somehow these two worlds, in quotes, have to be mapped. And to do this, we had a use case on the last hackathon employing open web developed by Rostrum and Kaus, which can produce feature vectors from annotated biological entities. Open web, as it is called now, is based on some protocol called open web, which puts the formal axioms and class of annotations, like for example, the certain plant, as given about these symbols and so on, and builds problems obviously. What is new in this version of the program is that also non-contributing metadata, like labels and synonyms and descriptions, whatever you find additionally in ontology, and ontologies and completely relates to the structure, that is all taken into account, and a new kind of corpus is based on that. Based on semantic reasoning. And this is the seed again on this very simple two-way word-to-vector algorithm in the pipeline, which works as an encoder again here. This network is pre-trained on a corpus that was already mentioned, a corpus which works as for the encoder for the vector of the word-to-vector. And it's done with all this public database because Python was developed in the context of an omics study. And in our case, we can use Florida data. This was a nice file, but there's one idea for an active around that's just that we can do any label category. And the outcome, of course, are then the next vectorized representation of the biological entities shown here as. Feature vectors of two species. The vectors in concern are usually much longer than shown here. This was last year's hackathon result, where we just did a simple dimension reduction of the output of the pipeline. This is shown here for some sort of prototype family called SEA, compared to two other groups. This is a group of water grasses which sticks together here, and this is Rayola SEA, which are all very little plants, flowers. They are very similar. Topics are quite diverse, but we could also already find some clusters in your acacia, indigo, and so on, and some are alone in a kicker. This was an old data set. I mean, that's quite messy, and it has to be improved, but you see some of the mess that you lose here. Here's a certain kind of tree, like structure, and so on. So there was already something in the data which might encourage us to go on with that procedure. And this is the idea for this year's hackathon. To employ, as I already mentioned, probably graph convolution networks, GCN, to different graph models, and to improve the whole pipeline. The basic thing with GCN is probably seen here that you have a kind of scanning of the input space, and instead of the word to web, where each word goes, so to say, alone through the network, you can here have an activation function. Similar to image processing, this is one of the dimensions which scans neighboring words, and you can consider particular relations of nodes and transform them in a common change of the nodes together. And this is used in the context of NLP, neural linguistic processing, to discuss semantic relations. And this is an example of a paper from Las Vegas. I found it very cool, as you can make it. And instead of the last word to where you don't get a simple output like a wild function, but then it makes it more difficult. So it makes it more difficult. There's a kind of association process, and that's the idea for this hackathon, to try this and to improve this results and get something better out and set up this a little bit messy sense. I shouldn't forget, there are many people to thank for, and in particular Rob and Maxed, who did a lot of the programming on the last hackathon, Marco Schmidt and Christina Brüller helped with the data provision, and many thanks to the organizers to make this possible.